Good morning. Perfect. I'm actually not a principal analyst. I'm only a senior analyst, so apologies for that. So first of all, let me say thank you for coming to the 9 a.m. session of the first day of Programmatic I.O. If I can claim any mild success in this industry, I owe it to the San Francisco ad community. So it's great to be home, and I'm excited to talk to you guys a little bit about how programmatic media buying has matured through the eyes of the marketer over the past few years. But before I get started, I just want to ask, why are there still people in this industry that don't believe programmatic is the anything but the single biggest fundamental change to happen in marketing over the past 25 years? In the time that we'll spend together this morning, nearly $5 million of digital media will have been purchased programmatically. For some of you, that's an annual digital media budget. And really, that breaks down into about $53,000 per minute. Current forecasts estimate that if I were to come back here and do the same workshop in 2019, those numbers will have tripled. So we'd be talking about $150,000 of programmatic media spend per minute. And really, this doesn't even start to explore some of the savings that marketers are seeing. Current forecasts estimate that the traditional way of buying digital media represents about $67 billion in global ad spend. And with some marketers seeing an upwards of 50% improvement in efficiency and effectiveness, in the time that we'll spend together this morning, marketers could have saved nearly $6 million by buying programmatically, and that breaks down into about $64,000 per minute. So there's a lot of money at stake, and there's a lot of ad dollars being left on the table. But whether you're a media coordinator who's generating campaign reports, or you're the CMO of a global brand who's setting budgets for your organization, we all have one thing in common. And that is that we're going through this transformation together. We're not necessarily going through this change because we want to in some cases. We're going through this change really because of our customers. Customers today expect more from brands, and they're going to continue to expect more from you tomorrow. Some industry experts believe that, like Moore's Law, customer expectation will double every 18 months. And so it's even more important for us today to really understand what customers expect. And today, customers demand a consistent, relevant, and valuable experience that's both device and channel agnostic. And you can really only deliver that type of experience programmatically. So programmatic isn't a channel, it's not a tactic that we're necessarily going to use to help meet this expectation. It really is a fundamental way of thinking and changing the way we think about marketing and transforming how we think programmatically in order to better serve our customers. In the next 85 minutes or so, we're going to review some data points that start to explore the progress that marketers have made, as well as the challenges that they still face. We're going to invite some industry thought leaders up on stage and talk a little bit about how they help marketers through this transformation by navigating people, processes, and technology. And then finally, we'll open it up and give you guys the opportunity to ask some questions that you have and maybe dive a little bit deeper into some of the topics that we talk about. The data that I'm going to present represents four surveys fielded between 2014 and 2016. The respondent levels vary from between 74 to 128 respondents, with each of those respondents representing different decision-making levels, as well as industry verticals. So let's check out a little bit about how this data starts to explore the progress that marketers have made over the past few years. The 2016 ANA survey revealed that marketers are getting smarter about programmatic. In fact, 66% say that today they both know what programmatic is and use it. And if you compare that number to what we saw in 2014, what you've seen is this dramatic increase in both knowledge and execution. In 2014, with the same ANA survey, we only saw 23% of marketers that could agree with this statement, that they both knew what programmatic was and were using it. We also found that a big contributing factor to this is the fact that we've all finally, maybe not all of us, but we're starting to agree on what the definition of programmatic is. And 80% of marketers from that survey agree that programmatic is the automation of the buying and selling of digital media with technology enhanced by data. So along with this agreement on the definition, marketers have really taken three approaches to improving their knowledge on programmatic. First, they're building out their own internal knowledge and expertise. 78% of the marketers that we talked to that were doing programmatic are investing in internal training. And by building out their knowledge and expertise, they've been able to transform the way that they think about marketing programmatically. Next, they've shifted their internal organizations to be closer to their data pros. 68% of the marketers that we talked to said that they have shifted their internal organizations to create closer collaboration between marketing and analytics. We also saw from the DMP wave that while the budget remains in the marketer's department for making decisions on DMPs, 23% are starting to bring data pros to the table as key decision makers in choosing that type of technology. Finally, they're getting more involved. Marketers are getting more involved with programmatic to address concerns about inventory quality, transparency, and data and technology ownership. We found that a third of respondents that we spoke with are working more closely with their DSPs, in order to create better research and reporting to increase their understanding of the quality of the inventory in the ecosystem today. And to increase transparency, 62% of the marketers that we spoke with are working more closely with their agencies in order to get more detailed campaign guidelines as well as reporting to improve their understanding of their programmatic buys. And a handful of marketers have started to create more direct relationships with ad tech. They're creating relationships with up to 11 different categories of ad tech, ranging from data management to fraud prevention and protection, as well as multi-touch measurement. And really what we saw from the DMP wave is that 72% of marketers had identified the data management platform as a key piece of technology that they needed to manage internally. So while we're getting smarter about programmatic, we're building out our own internal knowledge and expertise, we are getting more data aligned by connecting and getting closer with our analytics partners, and taking more ownership and responsibility when it comes to direct contracts with our ad tech providers, there's still a number of challenges that marketers find it difficult to face. For example, marketers are still accepting undisclosed pricing models with their agency partners. So it's hard to tell which is worse. Either the 40% of marketers that said that they aren't sure what type of pricing model that they have with their agency partners, or the 34% that know they're in an undisclosed model and they've opted in so they just have to accept it. Basically, 74% of marketers can really be categorized as being okay with opaque pricing practices today. One marketer even revealed to us that they felt pressured into opting into an undisclosed pricing model by their agency partners. And I'm not trying to say that marketers aren't finding value in working with their agency partners. 77% of the marketers that we spoke with in the ANA survey said that they still rely heavily on the expertise that their agencies have when it comes to programmatic. But that expertise isn't necessarily, doesn't warrant really being subjected to any type of undisclosed pricing model that might be in place today. And if undisclosed pricing models weren't enough to slow the adoption of programmatic, there's still a number of concerns about the transparency into inventory. 69% of marketers said that higher bot traffic is still a major concern for them when adopting programmatic. And even with the tools available to monitor quality and fraud, what we've seen is that only 45% of marketers are using sophisticated data, sophisticated fraud prevention and detection tools. So even with all these concerns about inventory, tools available to really protect yourself from fraud and bad quality traffic, marketers haven't done that much to take control. We have seen 24% of marketers start to put restrictions around source traffic, but when you start to think about things like private marketplaces or logging into console to sort of police and audit what's happening within your programmatic buys, there's not that much going on. In fact, 12% of marketers admitted to just doing nothing in order to protect themselves today. And we think that's because marketers find it difficult to manage technology. From the DSP wave, what we saw was that on average, marketers were working with between 4 and 6 different buying platforms. And in the worst cases, they're partnering with between 15 and 20 buying platforms when we start to talk about rolling out global programmatic. We also asked them who asked them to participate in the survey. And what we found is that 43% of those marketers were actually asked to participate in the survey by a partner that they wouldn't consider their primary buying platform. And it was clear to us that marketers are finding managing technology challenging, as 85% said that they would find value in using a single solution if it met all their needs. And even though there's an overwhelming number of marketers that have said that they would find value in using a single solution, only 66% said that they understood the differences between a single tech stack and point solutions. Even fewer said that they understood the resources needed to integrate a network of point solutions. And so what does this all mean? I mean, the data certainly can be interpreted different ways, but I think that there's 3 major takeaways that we can take from the data. First is that we've made good progress, right? We've made good progress as practitioners, we've made good progress as educators, and we've made good progress as evangelists. But we can still do more, right? Education is gonna be a huge part of what continues to push the adoption of programmatic in the next 5 years. Next, even though we're aware of a lot of the issues that exist in the ecosystem, we aren't really acting on them. Only 45% of marketers were using data fraud prevention and detection tools. That should really be at 100%. I don't know why we're not protecting ourselves if we're aware of the issues out in the space. So marketers need to continue to take action. Finally, it's really time to start thinking about programmatic outside of just digital media buying. Right? Programmatic is about trying to understand how data and technology can be used to enhance our ability to better win, serve, and retain customers. And that type of thinking really can permeate the entire modern marketing organization. So I'm going to invite the panel up. I'm not going to introduce them myself because I would probably wouldn't do them justice. Once we get situated, we'll go ahead and give them a minute to introduce themselves. Any order you'd like. We want Joanna in the middle. So. All right. You guys want to start at that end? Take a minute to introduce yourself to the crowd if they don't know who you are.
Can we, like,
hey,
make
everybody.
A more
hey, San Francisco.
A moon?
Kick back.
I thought maybe we'd kick these guys back a little so we could see.
Yeah, here we go.
Yeah,
here we go.
It's kind of hard to see them.
There we go.
I see many, many faces that I know and love and respect. But for those who don't know me, I'm Quentin George. I'm the co-founder and principal of a company called UNBOUND.
Great, thank you.
I'm Rudy Gran, VP of Data Strategy at Newstar.
I'm Joanna O'Connell. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer of MediaMath. I used to be a research analyst at AdExchanger, and before that I was a research analyst at Forrester.
It's like a family reunion.
Yes, it is.
I'm Paul Alfieri. I'm the Senior Vice President of Marketing for Turn.
Art Schram, head of product for Accuen, which is the programmatic practice inside Omnicom Media Group.
Amit, Ahuja, I'm responsible for Audience Manager at Adobe's DMP within the Marketing Cloud.
All right, and I'm Richard still. So Forrester has this framework where we talk about people, process, and technology with our clients. And so I thought that would be sort of a good framework for this discussion. So let's start off with people, right? And you guys, I'm sure, will jump in whenever you want. So one of the big challenges that marketers find today is finding the right talent to help them do programmatic. Where do you guys see your clients finding that talent? Is it external? Is it internal? What are your clients doing today to find people who can help them do programmatic? Joanna, why don't you go first?
Sure. Well, first, I think there's a lot of cross-pollination that you see. You know, you'll see someone who was at an ad technology company decide to go work inside of an agency. You'll see someone who was working at an agency decide to go inside of a marketing organization. And you'll definitely see marketers join technology companies. It's a little funny because it's actually a worry that I have when you see so many good marketers leaving their marketing jobs to go work inside of technology companies, which probably means that there's some work to be done inside of those marketing organizations to encourage that talent to want to be there and continue to innovate. I would say secondarily, it's funny because the talent problem is a really big one, and this is just a quick MediaMath thing. We built this thing called the New Marketing Institute a couple of years ago because we were really interested in creating educational opportunities in the space, and it's grown and grown and grown and grown because there's such a desire for information and education and training. We actually have this thing now called the MEP, the Marketing Engineer Program, mm-hmm. where we actually put people through several months of intensive training on not just technology, but marketing in general, and then we place them inside of organizations like marketing organizations, technology companies, and agencies.
Got it. And are you guys kind of taking the same approach when it for those of that view that it applies to?
Similarly, at Turn, I'd say the one thing that we always talk about is spend time with our customers, right, is you've got to hire a great marketer first, And just because you need an analytical skill set doesn't mean that bringing analytical talent into your organization is going to make it a great marketing organization. So I think what happens with a lot of our clients is they find evangelists, people who get really excited about programmatic, and that can be in any skill set. So it's not that we're looking specifically for a data scientist or for someone who's just at the financial institution. It's someone who's excited about the promise, about the numbers you just showed, and they become an evangelist and a catalyst inside that organization, because ultimately, if we want to get to that promise, programmatic can't be owned by someone. Programmatic and data needs to be part of everybody's job. And so finding that evangelist and then spreading it through the organization is incredibly important.
Believers, right?
Believers.
You want believers.
And Quentin, I'm interested to hear, like, how big of a role is education in some of the work that you guys are doing at Unbound?
Crucial. I mean, so first of all, we should acknowledge the fact that we, and celebrate the fact that we are involved in an industry that gives us such amazing opportunity, is growing at the rate that it is when so many other industries are in such rapid decline. So it's a good problem to have. The second thing is, as it comes to clients, I think most of the brands and publishers we work with today start to ask more strategic questions about what the role of programmatic and the role of data is. And so when you start to answer those questions, the next step down is to try and figure out who the appropriate skill sets are and where they reside to execute on that. I think there's this misperception that everything is moving so quickly into brands, and that agencies and third-party services providers don't necessarily have a role to play in that. I think the headlines are way ahead of the reality. But having said that, we do have a very, very big challenge in our industry, because to some extent our tertiary education facilities have failed us in the pursuit of what we have been doing in the last 5 to 10 years, in as much as preparing people for our craft. And so we haven't really leveraged the trade bodies. We're going to have to figure out a way to grow talent, because fishing in the same pond and having people outbid each other for the same talent, agencies are trying to take people away from ad tech is trying to steal from brands are trying to steal from agencies, and in the end, if you're a 25-year-old person with media chops and some analytics and statistical ability,
right.
I'll take your card if you're right. At the end of the but we have to prepare, and we have to work with the tertiary education facilities to help get people to be far more trained and ready for what we're trying to ask of them.
I think the rank and file, like just the people who are executing campaigns, we've actually taken the approach of starting to recruit kids directly out of college and train them from scratch, ultimately, because we can't find that talent or enough of it as the business scales so rapidly. Mm-hmm. So I think that's an investment that's going to pay off in the years to come.
Growing the talent probably is the best approach, but don't be frightened to take a multidisciplinary approach to this. Someone who's comfortable with search is not going to be freaked out by a bid environment in another channel. There are some basic core talents that can be channeled and grown in a direction that would allow them to become fluent in a multidisciplinary context.
I mean, you said it, Paul, I say it too. You go to a marketing organization and you encourage them to look for those people inside their team that are hungry and excited and want to do something new, rather than allowing that person to sort of die on the vine. Let that person shine. Let that person run with it.
And you kind of give them responsibility.
And Amit, you...
Yeah, I think from at least from the Adobe point of view, what we see, and I think it's been touched upon pretty well, I think there's kind of two different levels of DNA, and I think both are very much missing in the industry, right? I think number one, which we've talked about quite a bit, is the DNA to and the data science to understand what to do with all this data, how to execute on campaigns, which we've talked about. I think the second one, I think Joanna said it pretty well, which we see specifically is to deliver on the promise, and Richard, the way you talked about it, I thought was really, really good up front, which is programmatic is not just about one channel. I think the other big piece that's missing right now in the companies is just the ability to break down across all these different channels within the organization. So a lot of us come in, including Adobe, right? We come in and we show these great slides of, hey, you can use this data everywhere. You can use it across every channel. The reality is to make that happen, it's really, really hard.
And I think there's just a DNA issue within the enterprise to make that happen. Both, so how do you, number one, collaborate, get all those data pipes flowing, and then number two is what do you actually do with it?
Yep.
Right? I think both of those are lacking today.
I mean, it's interesting if you've looked at like the descriptions of the modern data scientist today, right? The sexiest role to have in 2015, whatever it might be, it looks like a superhuman. And really, a lot of those pieces I feel like are coming together from a team standpoint more than just an individual in a lot of places. But I mean, it's a good segue into starting to talk a little bit about processes. You know, you mentioned org structure as being a huge challenge just in collaborating, getting all these people together. I mean, what type of impact does org structure have on technology decisions these days and data choices and where you find that data?
It's unfortunate, but it has a lot, and it shouldn't at all. Mm. Right? Technology should be the enabler of your organization. And when we advise, like we work with companies in CPG and auto and B2B, they have wildly different org structures because that's what's right for their business. And their technology platform should enable what they're trying to accomplish. But what we see too often is siloed thinking. We, for a very large client, they may be here, so I'll kind of, you know, scale this back a little bit. We ran an offsite to try to talk about and get them set up, right? Like, we're gonna bring your data together. And very quickly, about 3 minutes into the opening session, we realized that the content marketing and the search teams had never met each other. Mm. Large multinational. And we had to go back and do an icebreaker. And so org structure today is having a large impact on technology, but that's because organizations are still planning and buying and activating and analyzing in silos and then trying to roll it up together at the end. And that's something that needs to be broken down.
And so are you guys trying to help those organizations formalize a process of collaboration and things like that?
You absolutely have to.
The fastest way to a failed deployment is to not include a stakeholder, to have some stakeholder come in late in the process who wasn't there to pick the vendor, didn't help build the default reporting and didn't get their data view baked into the process. Those are the things where the number of organizations where there are two competing groups doing the exact same deployments is shockingly high. So you absolutely have to get into the organization and market make before you can have a successful deployment.
You've probably seen this as well in clients that you work with, but the rise of the center of excellence, the rise of the incubator team, you know, the team that is tasked with taking the idea, running with it, and then evangelizing inside of the company. You know, what's great about that is that you do have some centralized thinking around technology, the promise of, you know, what we call programmatic marketing, again, so much bigger mm-hmm. than just paid media, right? Mm-hmm. But of course, they then face their own organizational challenges in convincing the rest of the org to sort of change the way it thinks and behaves. But what's nice is when those groups can show early signs of success, they have something they can take and show, right, as tangible success.
The challenges that I have with these skunk work teams, if you will,
right.
is, you know, we are in, and as you showed, we are in a phase of incredibly disruptive change. Marketing has changed more in the last 10 years than the last 100 years, mm-hmm. and whether you take programmatic's role in that in terms of distribution, content creation, so that's the backdrop. So usually in times like this, you have a CEO, and when there's disruption for a CEO, he calls McKinsey, or she calls McKinsey. If there is a CTO that says, well, stuff's blowing up, they're not connecting, they know they can call Accenture, and they can come and rely on the might of a big organization to lead that change. Mm-hmm. And you know, if there's accounting things, a CFO can call Ernst & Young, and Bob's your uncle. The problem is that there is no entity, there's no mature industry. And again, you know, we have individual point solutions, but there's no one that's advising a CMO how to manage this change. And once the change starts to go beyond programmatic, and you get to the question of, well, who owns the data? In a Fortune 500 organization, I think we're going to struggle for the next 10 years to mm-hmm. answer that. Because it's not just the ownership, it's the application of that data. Who's responsible for the tagging? Who's responsible for the usage? Are the legal people making sure that once we get sign-on, it's being able to use in different markets around the world? And so we have to teach an organization to think way, way broadly, more broadly about that. But then at the same time, you know, you can't just live in the world of strategy. You have to execute in these, you know, small teams to be able to show and lead with progress.
You know, it's funny. Who owns the data should be who owns the user, right? That's an enormous, I mean, I know. Yes, of course.
That's an even bigger question.
It's an even bigger question, but really, it's, you run into that. You know, this piece of the organization is running a retargeting campaign that doesn't actually talk to this other piece of the organization that's still running CPA campaigns, right?
I think what we've found is that we kind of sort of help create this problem by talking primarily about platforms and technology and losing the plot of the idea that really we're talking about is buying publishers and buying audiences and buying screens, et cetera. And I think what we're trying to do, I mean, every time someone says, you know, I'm gonna run a comparison between MediaMath and Quantcast on a media plan, a little part of me dies because ultimately, like, it's you know, that's not the idea, right? Mm-hmm. Programmatic is an underlying set of technologies that enables broader media buying, and I think we're trying to sort of, you know, deprogram that conversation of just talking about tech and platforms, you know, bring it out a little bit, which allows the involvement and the inclusion of a broader group of people. I think, you know, that's a key focus for us at the moment.
I mean, so what are the steps that you have to take in order to bring in those data owners, whether it's a small team or a combination of small teams? Like, what?
One of our largest customers, Kraft Heinz, appointed what they called a data czar. Right, mm-hmm. And that person was given operational responsibility to find and collect and centralize all of the data inside the organization, very similar to what Quentin was saying, right? And that for them unlocked different conversations. And there aren't that many organizations that are getting there yet, but mm-hmm. the key is centralize your data, figure out who owns it, and then figure out the permissioning around that, who gets to access what and when, and for what purposes. And if you bring that together, all of the other conversations you want to happen follow, and they're a lot easier because you know where to go to actually get started, which is going to be that data point.
I completely agree. At the end of the day, when we're selling into customers or we're having pre-sales conversations, whatever it is, I mean, this is the number one thing we bring up. We just say, hey, look, we can provide the best technology in the world, but this is probably the number one role we highlight. We just say, look, if you want success, bring in someone to do this. So we always go through best practice, and oftentimes it doesn't happen, and oftentimes it results in not a great spot. So it's more of an advisement role, you know, and oftentimes we bring in people to help that, but I think at the end of the day, this role is so critical, you're gonna see more and more companies get there.
And so, let's say you have special clients that are on board and they're willing to do, take all your advice and go to market. Like, one of the big things that that the industry is talking about today is, like, people-based marketing, right? So how important is your ability to pull different data from all these parts of the organization to better understand whether or not somebody is a person or, you know, a device, like we've kind of typically done that in the past. Do you have specific approaches to that or how you advise clients?
That's a rhetorical question, yeah, right? Because the answer is you have to do that, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Whether you call it people-based marketing or one-to-one marketing or personalized marketing, I mean, it's just a requirement now. And I think, you know, if you think about a year ago or so when, you know, dorks like us were thinking about it, or 2 years ago or 3 years ago, marketers weren't quite there yet, mm-hmm. probably mostly for the organizational reasons that we're talking about. They weren't ready to do anything about it. And so it wasn't sort of staring them in the face as a big problem. And I mean, I say happily, I guess, it finally feels like it is, where they are really starting to question, you know, how they are understanding an individual user's experience, which is both from a targeting standpoint and definitely from a measurement standpoint, right? How do I understand the impact of running in a cookieless environment in mobile on, you know, a desktop conversion? That's a one basic example, but enormously important.
You have to move past thinking about the device when you're talking about programmatic to thinking about the end user experience across channels, right? And the you can look at consumer journey or whatever term you want to use in there, but what it really allows you to do when you move past the device to the person is think about what's the experience you want to create for that person, and how do I keep that experience consistent across all those different types of touch points that consumer is actually going to have, whether it's a video ad or a unpaid social or even a phone call or a direct mail.
Sure.
And you mentioned something earlier in your opening talk about programmatic, and you said programmatic is transforming marketing. You didn't say advertising, and I know you said that on purpose, but that's when you get there and you think about people and experiences and the power of programmatic, it's not that programmatic is going to transform advertising. It's going to transform marketing in a way that makes it very much more experiential and very much more personal and allows all of us in the room as marketers to be able to finely tune those experiences based on whatever is going on in the lives of our target at that moment.
Much of what we're talking about is very forward looking, but it is important to understand that like people-based measurement and IDs, this is reach. How important is reach to marketing?
It's not reach.
It isn't.
Reach is a sub-component of it. Experience is much more than reach. Reach means...
For people-based marketing, I mean. If we're talking about people-based marketing, it's...
That's funny. Maybe we should throw that term out then.
Yeah. Which one?
People-based marketing.
Yeah.
Or maybe
I can understand the importance of true reach and frequency, even in managing experience, right? You have to be able to understand who you're reaching, whether or not they're rare people, to then influence the next experiences that they're gonna have within your programmatic marketing. I guess I'm curious, have you seen a lot of clients have success in managing that experience across all these channels?
I think it's still early. I think it's definitely having an impact, frankly, on the platforms and the technologies that we execute through. I mean, I think the importance of logged in identity has become very, very clear. And the fact that various partners are in some ways walling off that logged in identity changes the way that we look at the landscape from a platform and technology perspective. But I think it's still relative. I mean, and I think there's validity in saying that at some level, like when we talk about people-based marketing, in some ways we're answering the same questions that we had before about audience, who is my target audience? Where are they? Did I reach them? How are they responding to my advertising? I think the key thing is that the answers we're getting are more accurate on that level. So yeah, I mean but I do think it's early still for us, to see the real benefit of that or to actually put it into practice in a large way.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. There's so many meetings I walk into, and the conversation will be around what is the best model for attribution. Like that's a conversation we at Adobe have all the time. Oh, are you using algorithmic, are you using last touch, are you using equal weighting, whatever it is. Same thing on the targeting side. Oh, what are you doing around targeting? Back to the way you raised the question, Richard, if you haven't solved the data problem and reconciled identity, all those things are broken. I mean, it's just that simple. You want to deliver that continuous experience, you want to measure that continuous experience. To do that, you have to understand the consumer, right, holistically across devices, online, offline, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I think that's the foundational data layer. And I think the way we're approaching it is how do you extend that to that whole customer journey, paid, earned, and owned, such that consumer journey is effectively linked, right? And you make intelligent decisions across every step of it.
The problem with people-based marketing is not a media problem.
That's right.
It's a message and experience problem.
Sure.
And so, again, for all our success, we've done a pretty poor job engaging creative creation, people who create these assets, and convincing them that the advantage of programmatic in their minds is ought to be the sequencing of those experiences. So you don't have to work so hard to compress everything you know and want to tell and want to convince a prospect about something into a very small space or a very small time slot. Have them think about more creatively about the sequencing so you can tell stories, richer experiences over time that is now triggered by events, by what we know about you, by further data, and being able to deploy against that.
Well said.
It's so funny because ad sequencing is something we've sort of been talking about for a long, long, long time, and it just really hasn't been happening. And still in 2016, there's still not a ton of examples of that happening. And ad sequencing sounds really lame and boring and technical. I'm just talking about, relationship with user over space and time that changes, appropriately as that user is changing. And I'm so thrilled when I find examples of it inside the company where I now work. There should be many, many more. So when I find them, I crow about them. And I say, this is the best expression of the use of data and technology in creating a user experience that's meaningful and connecting a user through a brand. That sounds like nonsense, but it's true and real. And that's really what we should all be trying to do.
We've, we've We've had a client recently that had extraordinary success at doing single frequency impressions. A frequency of one. Mm-hmm. I show you a trailer. I see you again. I don't show you the same trailer. Novel concept, but extraordinary business results, just because we're starting to think more creatively about the consumer and not about the funnel that we want to push people through.
And if you're a channel, if programmatic is a channel, you can't achieve that vision ever, right? And that's the big change.
I think that's a good transition to the technology discussion. I mean, a lot of marketers out there struggling with this idea of best of breed versus single stack. You know, there's obviously some limitations, I think, in either approach that you take. What are you guys seeing your clients doing? How are they approaching that technology discussion to create that experience, and what are the challenges they face there?
Why don't we start with an agency guy?
Sure, yeah, I'll start with that. I think I'll answer it in this way. I think philosophically we're aligned to the concept of to the things that make a single stack solution great. In other words, we've seen tremendous improvements in effectiveness when we consolidate platforms. I think it's sort of what you were alluding to in your presentation earlier. I think that's absolutely clear. And we're coming from a place where we were much more quote unquote agnostic about platforms, you know, the ability to sort of the idea at a time that was like, you know, test all kinds of different DSPs and sort of continually understand which ones are better at this type of campaign business. I think that world is evolving for us and has changed into a place where we're consolidating dollars for particular clients into specific platforms. That said, all of that is true except for the fact that if you, you know, true single stack isn't really what we're talking about. I think single stack assumes that you're using just one sort of set of technologies. Mm-hmm. Because of the stuff I was alluding to earlier, which is the walling off of data, of inventory, et cetera, I think we look at the world as, you know, trying to consolidate platforms, but obviously being expedient in executing against, call it proprietary inventory assets that may be in one platform or another. So vis-a-vis our clients, we're talking about, you know, a primary platform and then a set of secondary platforms that that have unique assets. In other words, if you're not using a Google stack, but you still want to buy YouTube, at some level you have to use DBM, for example. Mm-hmm.
I think from our standpoint, first, taking my Turn hat off, before I was at Turn, I was at a B2C consumer electronics company, right? And there are kind of three things that we talked about. One is we don't want 16 different logins for the team. That's bad just from a training and scale standpoint. Two, what we're trying to find out is what works, what didn't, and why, so we can do more of what works and less of what didn't. But then third, one platform for everything we want to do doesn't exist. It's a unicorn. So I think the way that I talk to customers about is the thing you have to look for is where are the gaps between your systems and how is that going to affect execution. What we found is if you've got a gap where you're storing data and where you do your analytics from where your execution is happening, you're in trouble, right? Like insight should be immediately linked to action in places where it makes sense. We see, you know, Turn, MediaMath too, right? Seems millions of impressions a second, right? Like I don't even know how many impressions have happened while we've been sitting here on this stage. And so if there's something amiss and you can't react for another 15 million impressions, you're wasting money, you're wasting time, and you're losing results. And so that insight and action have to be linked. So how does the answer to that question is, I think clients don't want something that's a mile wide and an inch deep. But what clients do want is to be able to have that single source of truth wherever they can, and so it's a balance. And so what we see is where insight and action need to be linked together, like in programmatic advertising, that's what they do. Where but programmatic advertising doesn't necessarily need to exactly be linked to say unpaid social in a real time basis, and so they'll use a unifying layer on top. And they use best of breed for experimentation. So it's a hodgepodge, but all in trying to get those logins down from 17 to a more manageable one.
What matters to me is that the systems are talking to one another. I think, you know, if you have a stack, whether it's single, although you wouldn't see this in a single stack necessarily, but if you have a group of technologies that you stick together and the data is only flowing unidirectionally, you're losing a lot of the power of adaptiveness and responsiveness that is inherent in programmatic marketing in its most beautiful, you know, end state. So what I care about is that there's some bidirectional data flow and that it's seamless and you're not losing data. so that what happens in this instance of a consumer experience is kind of instantly able to inform the next instance of a different, that same consumer's experience elsewhere. And that's really important. And I don't know that people actually think about that idea enough, that these systems need to be able to communicate.
I was just going to add to that is that not everybody necessarily needs a full service integrated open source stack, but everybody does need partners that work well with each other, that talk well with each other and are compatible. There are some walled gardens and some walls going up that I think are troubling. It's something you do have to take very seriously for exactly the reason Joanna said. The data does eventually have to create a single story and it has to be actionable to many people. You're going to need vendors who play nice with each other.
So we've advised about a dozen brands over the last 2 years on exactly this question. And I think starting out with single stack versus best of breed is the exact wrong place to start. We've always found it very useful, and I see one of my clients here, so I better be very honest now. Keep me honest there, Julie. What you have to start is think about functional abstraction. What are the functions that you want to accomplish inside of your marketing organization? What pieces of technology do you need to execute against that? And once you have that firmly in your mind, you can start a selection process to try and understand, if I were to evaluate a best-of-breed solution in the DMP bucket or the DSP bucket, what is it that I'm looking for and what is it that I find? Now, there is value. There is no doubt that there's value in aggregating some of those capabilities together in a more comprehensive entity. And some of them will say that it's data leakage, and some of them will come up with some validation associated with that. I think it's very early in our cycle to be able to have something that can compete with a best of breed solution. The second thing that I would probably say is there's going to continue to be consolidation in our market. In the 12 clients that we've worked with, not a single time have we advised our clients on exactly the same stack, not even remotely the same combination of features. And in some of those instances, we've gone with single stack solutions. But if you go in with a preconceived notion of what that is, I think you do yourself a disservice because you'll always try and find a way to justify your decision or find excuses for why it doesn't fit the mold that you have.
Sure. From an Adobe point, a couple things. Number one is I would say over the last year and a half, the conversation we have with the CMO and the marketing organization is this too freaking hard, right? And I think people are tired, of looking at the Lumascapes and seeing 1,000 logos pre-consolidation. So I think to one extent, at least from the Adobe approach, we very much think there's value in simplifying this down. I don't think the question of single stack and best of breed are mutually exclusive, right? I think people tend to approach it that way and say, is it best of breed? Is it single stack? I think the way we approach it is, look, we have to be best of breed, right? And I think one of the ways we make them best of breed is by making it easier. So how do you connect all these applications together? How do you inform your media buying with analytics? How do you inform it through the DMP? I think the way we approach it is, how do we bring it and simplify and provide that integration out of the box? But at the same time, you have to be best of breed. Right, so I don't think they're mutually exclusive, and I think the pattern we're seeing more and more, especially at the larger enterprise customers, is, look, I'm tired of dealing with 25 vendors, to your point about logins, I want to standardize, right? They're not going to standardize on everything, I completely agree with that, but to some level, they're saying, I want to start standardizing. Who am I going to look to for this? Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of the market cloud game that we're playing.
Listen, you're going to have a couple core sets of technologies at most. Those technologies need to be flexible and extensible enough that they can very easily work with little innovative, nobody ever thought about it before, applications or technologies that are doing things that no one contemplated 2 years ago. It has to work that way.
I think there's just a functional execution advantage. For just a person who is executing media campaign to be sort of in a limited set of platforms at some level, rather than trying to wrangle 1,000 platforms. I think that's an evolution in the thinking. We still look to try to bring together best of breed solutions, but again, the idea of someone logging into 19 platforms, I think, is just not workable anymore.
Yeah. Paul, along some of the things that you said, you identified, for example, the data piece and the execution piece as being two pieces that need to be very tightly integrated. Are there other pieces of technology that you guys think really need to be incorporated into? You mentioned that core set of technologies.
Yeah. I mean, what matters, right? I mean, to me, it matters that there's a foundation of identity, right? Identity resolution, resolving to a single identity and identity management. On top of that, you have a core of data and data management. And on top of that, you have layers of execution, mm-hmm. right? And you just need to think about how those systems are talking to one another, whether it's a single set of systems or it's a group of systems. Ultimately, that's it, right? Identity, audience, and finding those people.
I couldn't agree more. The one thing I would add is content.
Right, so the way...
Oh, right, that's right.
Yeah.
The storytelling part.
Yeah, no, and I think that is the answer. It's basically data and content. And what you do is you have intelligent pipes bringing these things together. You have intelligence sitting on top of them. And then you say, okay, how do I deliver this intelligence across all these different channels? Again, whether that's paid, earned, or owned, all these lines are going to blur. Mm-hmm. But the key is, how do you provide a platform that enables you to bring all these things together, share them across the asset, and have all the pipes to make it actionable?
Yeah. And I'll just, it's implied in data, but I'll call out analytics and insight in the post mm-hmm. After that. If you've got to like download 2 terabytes of data from one system and upload it into something else that you can do the mashup and figure out what's going on, you're doing it wrong, right? Like that's where you're losing time and speed. Speaking as a head of marketing, that's the most frustrating thing, is I need answers now because I don't have an unlimited budget, right? Like, and right. I need that answer right now. So even if if there's a percentage off, I will take a margin of error on something that I can get quickly so that I can get my team moving. And I think that's how a lot of people have to think about it.
Well, there's intelligence. I'm sure you guys have opinions on kind of intelligence and measurement.
Well, closing the loop, certainly right. Bringing that measurement to bear. And while I love the data visualizations, it's getting so much better. Piping it directly in and taking right. that attribution product and turning it into a bid solution really is, I wouldn't say everybody's there yet, to your earlier point. Like, I think some of the brochure might be ahead of the practice on that, but closing the loop and making sure that all of this data that you've gathered and that the scorecard you've built informs the next round. Your own data is the best data to plan around, and bringing that to bear really is the last step. We are there, yes, yeah. I agree.
But it's funny because customers aren't there. You know, it's like the capabilities now exist to do things like port your post-attributed data right into the execution platform. It is so concerning to me how few of the customers out there that are really advanced in a lot of ways are actually taking that last step. I haven't totally figured out why, if it's organizational barriers. They're not over the organizational barriers, maybe.
Where do you think we are in terms of applying data to content?
I want to know what he thinks.
On that question?
Yeah. This idea of like making it actionable, like transcending channels, right?
Yeah, you know, look, the philosophical challenge that we have is this stuff is not, it's not necessarily complex. The role of advertising is, first principles, is very simple. It's supposed to get consumers to develop preference for one product over another, right? So begin there. Then we have to orchestrate a series of experiences in front of them that can take them up on a path from, I don't know anything about you, to this is the right thing, I'm gonna do something about that. And we have that as a relatively modest goal. And then on this side, we've built an entire economy around impressions and volume and reach and conversion, and we treat these two things as if they are completely separate problems to solve. Mm-hmm. 99% of the times, senior marketers inside of organizations have very modest, very simple, very specific problems to solve. We as an industry need to do a much, much better job of trying to listen and understand what it is that they need, as opposed to saying, well, we've got all these advanced use cases, if we can do multi-channel attribution for different, that's not the question that they're asking.
Sure.
There's some very, very simple goals. And so we have to think a lot harder about how do we close that gap? What are the right forums to close those gaps? Because I bet you 90% of what we're gonna talk about on the stage for the remainder of the day are going to be these phenomenal edge cases in which, you know, if this moon is in Aquarius and you've got reach 3 people in Bhutan, you know, with this particular fine sign, we've got 100% conversion rate. That's not reality. Mm-hmm. The reality is that these problems are far more simple. Now, It's a little bit like the last 5 pounds that I'm carrying. I know what I need to do. It doesn't mean it's easy. It doesn't mean it's easy. Sure. It's simple, but it doesn't mean it's easy.
Well, and here's the thing. I think we've naively, probably 9 years ago, thought we could, and I was at an agency 9 years ago, I could just, you know, have technology and all of my problems would be solved. Like, you know, a company like MediaMath would hand me technology and instantly I'd be brilliant with it. No. So I think there's been an enormous, you know, learning curve for probably all of our organizations on how you think about helping a marketer solve business problems. All that said, I do think even when you're speaking that language, there is that last 5 pounds,
yeah,
right, that they're not yet able to get rid of. And it's, you know, it's diagnosing why. You know, when they understand that porting, sorry, it's getting nerdy now, but porting that data back into the execution platform actually is a good thing, why they're not able to take that step.
I mean, are they starting to ask the right questions?
Lots more of the right questions, but not always getting to the point where they're doing something about it. And that's the part we all need to help them figure out why and help them take that step. The last 5 pounds.
Quentin used the word orchestration, which I thought was a good word. You know, we said earlier, right, technology is that enablement later. What we're all trying to do is orchestrate those experiences across the journey. And I think, you know, for me, you know, I was just sitting here doing some math of my own, right? Like Turn plugs into everybody here one way or another. I'm sure everybody's just everybody else, you know, and we've got SAP and IBM and Oracle and lots of others that all plug into us here as well. The technology is supposed to help all of you orchestrate that journey through programmatic advertising and programmatic email and programmatic web content and programmatic whatever else in a way that's most beneficial to the customers you're trying to reach. And I think for me, that's where we want to get to. And if we start talking about, if we start with the technology conversation, right? If the first conversation is, well, how many pixels do you fire, or how is your APIs work? Then you're lost, right? It is about what experience you're trying to orchestrate, and how can your piece of technology, how can I log into that, and how can you help me orchestrate that experience?
I think it's like if you think about platforms that are programmatic today that are sort of a little bit outside the scope of this conversation, you think about a system like Facebook ads, for example. I think the simplicity of those systems, you know, is so attractive at some level, and I think it's so difficult for us who are dealing with this stitching of processes together, which are complex. And the reality is, you know, for technologists like myself who kind of come into this and like to talk about technology, it's figuring out how to stop doing that, because people tend to glaze over and basically, you know, go back to those marketing points as Quentin was saying. And I think that's that re-education process that's so critical.
Great. So I guess now we'll open it up for some questions. You guys up for questions from the...
Sure.
Anybody?
Nothing. Quiet room.
It's yeah. Still early.
Still early. It is.
Yeah.
Maybe grab a cup of coffee and come.
All right.
Yeah.
Hey guys, Tim Fleischer, digital marketing strategist at ServiceMaster. I really love the discussion you guys had about ad sequence along the customer experience journey and transcending channels. I think that was a nice keyword. Let's say I get everybody at my company, every channel team on board, but we don't have the money to finance a DMP, right? What do you think, how do we make our channels talk to each other the best to kind of leverage and make them talk to each other the best way without
Secret
having that?
Is you don't really need a standalone DMP for that. You don't. I mean, you really don't. You know, you can use a technology platform that has that capability built into it. Like that is part and parcel of a good omnichannel platform. So that's the very short answer.
I mostly agree. I think as long as you're talking about advertising.
Yeah,
Joanna's exactly
that's
right.
Fair. No, that's
if
fair.
You want to think about stitching
actually,
more
no,
things together than just advertising, email,
still
and other
not
pieces.
Necessary.
No, I think I think what you need to do is make sure that you have that view. So what I'd say is you can get started with advertising. If you want to start stitching multiple channels together, you need that common ID. The place you're
right.
going to get that is
you
a
can
DMP.
Still get that in a single well, platform.
It's not a metaphysical.
This is why right. this
we
is
agree.
Exactly what's bad for the industry.
No, we agree. We agree.
Right?
We agree.
Is that you know we just had a discussion about what's important, and it starts with the foundation of a user ID. And
yeah.
So what I would say is that user ID, you're going to need to get there something, but. For you, start in advertising, just start collecting data somewhere. Put throw tags on your website
we
and
agree.
Collect data anywhere. and see where it goes.
We agree.
You need to get to a common ID, right? You need to figure out a way to stitch together. That's what a DMP does. If you want to use a DMP to do it, there's other ways to do it. I think that's the point being made, right? But you just got to get
your media execution is programmatic today. I think that's one question. I mean, I think it goes to if you have that notion that you can do it based on a technology platform like a DSP or indeed an ad server. You know, I think the question is, what's the scope of your marketing today, and does it expand beyond sort of what would be addressable within that channel?
I'm going to call us out. We're confusing media and marketing.
I was going to say, it's not just media.
Right. That's the difference, I think, what Amit and I are talking about versus marketing and versus media.
And even still buzzwordy, right? We're talking about paid channels versus owned channels, like your website or email.
All IDs are not created equally, however. You do need an ID in common, but you need a persistent one. Not every ID that is stitchable or knowable is going to hold up. So I would look into the, you know, how often are cookies dropped that you're stitching? How many machines look new that you've already seen 100 times? I mean, these are things that are knowable.
We may be illustrating the point why some of this stuff hasn't happened, right? I mean, at some level, like, what you're describing is actually not an impossible problem to solve. If you're just trying to sequence messaging at some level, you can do it and evolve, right? I mean, I think certainly there's that, you know, that broad vision, but yeah, I guess.
Right.
Do you have multiple messages that you can sequence?
We're working on it.
Good.
You should spend most of your time trying to figure out what the sequence of events are. These are sophisticated problems for how that gets executed. But once you are very clear about the sequence of events, the messaging, what those triggers ought to be, you know, you can knock on any door and they'll figure out what the right solution is to try and get you. They might not all come at the same level of cost efficiency, but you know, if you're clear enough about the problem that you want to solve, there are people who can solve that.
Yeah.
Just don't ask it in the way that you're asking it here, because then you're going to get this.
Got a question.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
Hi. Tessa Ohlendorf with Cadrian in Toronto, Canada. Sequential messaging and how creative agencies and programmatic partners talk to each other has been fascinating for a really long time. I think that's where the problem really exists, is creative is so far away from everything that we do in programmatic that, you're right, it's the most essential part of how to get that user experience and that direct experience going, but yet creative being way over here and programmatic and all this stuff is way over here, still getting those two sides to talk to each other to make a meaningful story happen is, I think, one of the biggest barriers. I'm just wondering if you have any insider experience with that.
Can I give you a high five?
But be careful. You can't buy a sequence. You can learn what an optimal sequence of messaging is, and maybe they leap channels. Read your media contracts. You may not even be able to take an audience exposed here, bundle them up, and ship them over somewhere else because there's lift when you do that. So you can't necessarily buy a sequence. What you have to do is leave yourself some options to control when an opportunity comes, what action are you going to take? You don't necessarily get to create a linear experience, but when the opportunity comes, you have a chance to manage those opportunities in sequence.
I really want to hear from Adobe.
Yeah, exactly. The reason I say I give you a high five is because I think you're just spot on with the question, right? I think as an industry, again, all of us included, we get so caught up in talking about data and segments of one and look what we can do around data. We can do that today, right? That's beautiful. We can create the segment of one. The problem is exactly your point. The content is not there, right? And this is a huge thing that we're trying to tackle. So one of the cool things, not to make it a sales pitch at all, one of the cool things we're doing is basically how do you take all this content, which by the way is all in these tools that Adobe develops, right? Photoshop, Illustrator, and just natively pipe that in. So what we're trying to do is do two things. One, how do you bring that content right into a content repository sitting in the marketing cloud? And then two, how do you dynamically optimize that content next to that data, right? And we're not there. I mean, I'll be the first one to say that there's a huge amount of runway there. I think that's been the missing piece, and that's why I called out content earlier. It's just, that's such the key part to the storytelling, and it hasn't come along for the ride as much. But I think we can bring it along for the ride and actually make it more dynamic, again, across any channel. We get so caught up talking about paid, right? But it's paid, earned, known. How do you create that consumer journey? It comes back to content. Let the data inform it. So that's what we're trying to do.
I mean, Quentin brought it up earlier, right?
You've got to, look, I mean, the thing is, and I haven't been in Cadrion for a while, so hopefully there's some good things that have been happening since our departure. The thing that I would say is you need to lead with value, because if you're you know, a creative director with a black turtleneck on a couch having big thoughts about what the next campaign should be, it's not really useful for us to say, yeah, you know, your impressions on Yahoo, you know, just it's not working so well. We don't love it that much. That's not useful insights. What is it that we can do to give these types of audience insights to the content creators so that they can be inspired to understand and gain empathy and create things around that? Now, that doesn't mean if you say, you know, people in four-seater passenger cars, you know, are interested in pets, you know, create an ad about pets. But we have to have a dialogue in which we, the people who sit on top of the data, turn that data into insights and give them the insights that can start the dialogue. Because otherwise, what's in their mind is when you talk about performance and analytics, it's, you know, here come the media geeks trying to tell me that I need to do A-B testing and create 75 versions of my wonderful ad and chop it into multiple pieces. I don't think it's what we want to say. I don't think it's what we mean to say. But there's a cultural gap between those things. And so if we can develop those types of audience insights, you know, I've seen it firsthand in the media entertainment industry, people who cut, you know, trailers for blockbusters, who you think would be the furthest away from this, mm-hmm. are most interested in understanding how their assets perform and what kind of context with what type of audiences. That's how you start the conversation to change.
Getting access to, you know, that guy in the turtleneck who's developing a big thought, like, there's still no bridge. Yeah. We might be two agencies away.
I
feel like it's got to be a full circle at the table conversation, and that just never happens.
It does. You've got to start with your client, right? The brand itself has to demand that everybody sits at the table.
I agree with
that. That's where we see that, right? Like, the creative, the media, and the technology partner, you can't separate any of those things. You need to be sitting down with the brand, setting those objectives. And if you don't have that conversation, you're going to get into that the situation that you're describing. But the imperative is on the CMO or their lieutenants to make sure that everybody is sitting at the table and very clear about they're all equals and there are and what they're supposed to be accountable for back to the team.
That's the right way to do it. Pursue that with all over the next 2 quarters. But pick up the phone, call the person, start a conversation.
That's the next one.
Just get going. I don't know if you're going to be successful, but it's a lot better than coming back 2 quarters hoping that we're going to, you know, rejoin creative and media in this wonderful briefing process where we all talk about the customer journey. That's an ideal.
You sound skeptical. Either programmatic has to go about making the creative, or we have to find a better way to communicate, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I think at our level, we're trying to create that bridge. I mean, I sit on a floor with two creative agencies. I mean, we could do a lot more to create that. And I think Quentin's point about the framework, rather than saying your creative isn't working, is sort of not very productive. I mean, you have to say this is a new toolkit that you can bring to the table to make, you know, creative better. I think that's the answer.
Cool. One more.
I would say that, like, we decided to do this in-house.
Let's do that.
Time for one more. I think we have time for one more question.
Hey guys, my name is Bennett Rosenblatt. I work in growth marketing at Uber. I wanted to go back to the consolidation versus solo partner question that you guys answered earlier. What's the DSP's role in navigating the chaos of ad tech? I feel like the dream that was sold about using DSPs way back in the day when they first started was that it would be your one-stop shop. They would do all the integrations and almost work as like a modular solution. I mean, I actually used to work at MediaMath too, so Joanna, big fan. But yeah, like, what's the DSP's role in that?
I'm not gonna answer that one then, someone else.
Well, first of all, I mean, growth, what chief growth guy at Uber?
I mean, that's got to be the easiest job in the world. Like, seriously, how many more people have signed up since you've been sitting in this?
It's because of him.
Look, the problem that I have with your question is you're asking it in the wrong place, because, you know, MediaMath is a great DSP, Turn is a great DSP, there are a lot of great standalone DSPs. But whichever DSP you're going to ask, what do you think they are going to put forward as the primary solution? Themselves. And so what you have to do is to just go a step up and start to just think about these things in different functions. Data. Where am I going to capture the data? How am I going to capture that data? What am I going to do with that? That's one set of questions. Where is the best place to have that? Is it better to have it closer to me? Is it better to have it in the cloud? Is it better to have it somewhere else? Step one. Step two. Now that I have that data and I push it into different buying platforms, some are going to be television, some are going to be one day, some are going to be digital, some are going to be display, some are going to be search. Right. There's probably going to be more than one that you're going to need to be able to do that. So consolidating around that is maybe not such a smart idea. Once you have those two things, you can start to think about the activities that surround that. Workflow automation, reporting, the ad verification, all of those other things. I don't think that there's a single successful best-of-breed company that is not already integrated with the other companies. But the problem is if you start, it depends on the node that you start. And if you start with the DSP node, that's not the right point of entry. It's a very crucial point of execution, but it's not the point. Start with the data. What is it that you want to capture from the audiences that you know, that you have control over? And then what do you want to do with that afterwards?
There's no DSPs up here anyway, right? There's a marketing hubs, marketing operating systems.
No, we're not a marketing operating
system. Sorry for my insult.
I killed that one.
All right, do we have time for one more?
Yeah, go for it.
Great. There's a guy up here that's
very eager.
Very eager to ask his question. Good.
Thank you. Nico from Union South Australia. I have a question. We touched on reach, and I'm always amazed how many brands have as a KPI cookies they served, right? Like, that's their KPI. And we talk about people-based marketing going away from that because you can obviously create cookies artificially. But I'm wondering, how much damage have we done by teaching clients using the wrong KPIs, this mid-funnel metrics, instead of focusing on behavior, right? If you're focused on, do people actually buy something, we would never had this level of, or probably would have noticed the level of ad fraud or other things happening before. What do you think about this, and do you see this changing more and more?
It's funny, isn't it? Marketing before all of this, 25, 30 years ago, was exactly the latter point, right? It was about behaviors, and we had very easier KPIs, right? Like, did they actually go in the store and buy the widget? And then we introduced all this technology and created all these mezzanine KPIs, like you said, and then we trained everyone, we got to focus on these things because this leads to this, leads to this, leads to this, leads to this, leads to the other thing. I'm going to go back to Quentin said this a lot, right? Like, in a lot of different ways. Start with the objective of what you're trying to do, and that's where you've got to focus your clients, and that's where you've got to focus the technology people, and that's where you've got to focus the agencies and the creatives on, is like, what are the things you're trying to do? And more than likely, it's not a click, it's not a reach number, it's, you know, we have one partner, it's like, I just want to sell a case of beer, right? Like, that's what you want to do, right? And work backwards from there. What's your objective? And get rid of it. And have we done some damage? Maybe we have. Maybe there are some people that have made careers out of optimizing to a metric that's in the middle of actually that chain. But what's most important is that we reorient our teams back towards those metrics, and then we reorient all our partners, including companies like Turn, towards that final business-changing metric, and not any of the KPIs in the middle.
I would just say, cookies don't have experiences, cookies don't buy cases of beer, they don't have experiences and all this. People do, and you're trying to assemble a data set. Yes, we may have to use machine IDs and device IDs and proxies, but we are trying to create a people-centric measurement set, and your objectives are eventually going to be how many people that I want to target can I expose to my audience and how much exposure do they need. That is still basic reach and frequency. You're trying to create a deduplicated data set that eventually ladders up to being a human being, and I think every aspect of marketing benefits if you start from that place.
Thanks. Great. think that's it. It's a long, long panel.
Thanks, buddy.
You guys all look really tired.
Let's,
now. It's like a marathon.
Let's frequency cap this one.
Yeah, yeah, seriously. All right, thanks, everybody. Thanks, man. Thank you.
Thank you very much.